Well, it looks like you're the one who needs to be taught a lesson, pal. Class is paying 101. Your instructor's Casey Jones.
Look, I don't want to fight you.
Well, tough rocks, pal.
It's a cup of coffee in the big time, yeah. Cup of coffee in the big time.
Hey, what do you say we both be independent together, huh?
And we have the tools, we have the talent. It's Miller time.
I said empty your mind. Be formless, shapeless, like water. Now you put water into a cup, it becomes the cup. You put water into a bottle, it becomes the bottle. You put it in a teapot, it becomes the teapot. Now water can flow or it can crash. Be water, my friend.
The world ain't all sunshine and rainbows. It's a very mean and nasty place, and I don't care how tough you are, it will beat you to your knees and keep you there permanently if you let it. You, me, or nobody is going to hit as hard as life. But it ain't about how hard you hit. It's about how hard you can get hit and keep moving forward, how much you can take and keep moving forward. That's how winning is done. Now, if you know what you're worth, then go out and get what you're worth. But you got to be willing to take the hits. And not pointing fingers saying you ain't where you want to be because of him or her or anybody. Cowards do that, and that ain't you. You're better than that.
Well, that's great. Either I have a monster in my kitchen or I'm completely crazy.
I don't think you're crazy.
You know something? Maybe I am insane.
You know what you need? You need a Brazilian plastic surgeon.
I've got one that can see.
It's showtime.
All right. What's up, everybody? Welcome to Comic Book Radio. I'm your host, Peter Cimetti. And tonight, my guest is Neon from Clownfish TV for this 56th episode. Man, 56. Welcome, Apex Comics. How are you doing? We got Levi Skeen here, too. What's up, Levi? Manny in the chat as well. Hey, Manny, thanks for joining us tonight. Wayne is here too. What's up, Wayne? Hey, AL, how's it going? Hope you're doing well. Jed Ojaga saying, Pete and Neon together, collaboration incoming. It's a conversation. A conversation. But I appreciate the excitement, which AL is excited for. Yes, exactly. We got Dan Genovese here. What's up, Dan? Hope you're doing well. Buddha Bear in the house as well. Dan says, my copy of Crimson Rain arrived last week. There you go. Very nice. Crude Buster, hey, how you doing? Thank you for being here tonight. Uriah, what's up? Says, this is an interesting crossover. It's not that interesting. Me and Neon have known each other at this point for a few years. We're just busy. We're catching up tonight, though. What's up? Ruby Jade, hope you're doing well. JW Learning is here. Cole King in the house. Let's see. AL says, I know my copy has been shipped, but I won't get it till after I come back from vacation. Ah, well, I'm sure you'll enjoy it when you get it. Just a Backer, hey, how you doing? Ara is here as well. What's up, Ara? And James, what's up, James in the house? Hey, and Chris is here too. Okay, without further ado, let's bring on the man of the hour. The one and only Neon from Clownfish TV. What's up, buddy?
Thought you were talking about somebody else. You know, like the man of the hour. Yeah, hey, how's it going? It's been a while. My God, it's been what we were talking before the show. It was like, what, like 2 years? I think 2 years since we talked?
About, yeah. I can't remember specifically anymore. There's people that I thought I talked to like 6 months ago, and I'm like, oh my God, I haven't talked to you since 2020.
Yeah, I'm really bad with time anyway. My wife gets on me all the time. She's like, you know, I'm like, hey, we just did that like a couple of months ago, right? And she's like, no, that was like 3 years ago. Yeah. 3 years ago is when you cleaned the garage last. That's been a while.
Yeah, I feel that, man. That's where I've been. And it feels sometimes it feels good in terms of like, oh, wow, cool. You know, I'm getting so much done over that period of time. And then the other time it feels like, man, what's happened? Where's everything gone?
Yeah. All right. So we're talking about comic books, right?
We're talking comics. We're talking creating content, commentary on pop culture, because you guys are have been doing this for a few years now in terms of offering a, I hate to say something like an alternative viewpoint to the mainstream, what they're usually saying, because that always makes it sound like it's contrarian, but it's you guys are offering an honest viewpoint from your point of view, which is so difficult to find. And you guys were doing that at a time when a lot of people really weren't. And I think that's what really drew a lot of people to your content, both you and Geeky.
You know, it's weird. We haven't changed at all. Like our opinions, we used to go, you know, they used to invite us to conventions all the time. We'd talk about comics, we'd talk about web comics, we'd talk about, you know, making a living online and all that stuff. And our views are exactly the same as they have been for the duration of the time we've been doing it, you know, so everything else changed. That's kind of what happened. Like, I mean, our you know, personal politics and whatever. I mean, I'm considering myself a very political guy, but I started to see some weirdness, you know, with the mainstream media. I'm like, things are changing. All these news outlets all sound like Tumblr blogs now. Something's definitely up. Something's in the water. And you know, but yeah, we've actually just kind of held the line, you know, and everything else kind of changed around us, yeah. Which is kind of weird. I feel like, you know, you watch a movie and you see like them building skyscrapers around a little, you know, brownstone or something in the middle of the city. That's what kind of felt like. And
you're like Woody, and the whole room is changing, right?
Yeah, pretty much. And that's just kind of the way I think a lot of fans have been. They're like, they got blindsided by, you know, if there's any controversy, I think it's a lot of it's just all ginned up because the whole scene has changed, you know, and it happened so quickly. And but the vast majority of people are still pretty normal. I think that the vast majority of people in this space are still pretty normal. They were afraid to say anything for a long time, you know, and now it seems like after the rest of us have taken all the hits, now it's okay to say something. It's okay to speak up. And
yeah, I mean, that's just kind of how it goes, right? I mean, that's just history in a nutshell. Well, you'll largely see things happen where someone comes along and, you know, they'll ridicule them. They'll even do, in terms of history, you could talk about, they'll even execute the damn person. Oh, yeah. And then generations later, oh yeah, we knew they were always right. You know, let's erect a statue, just a little quick apology. Oh, we shouldn't have executed that person.
Oopsie. Can't make an omelet, right? Can't make an omelet without cracking a few eggs. But I mean, we're seeing it now in the comic book industry. Like, we've been doing videos lately, like everybody's they're doing like a 180 now. The main, you know, a lot of these news outlets and stuff, it's like you guys were demonizing fans for years, and now you're agreeing with them all of a sudden because it's safe. Mm-hmm. Or you're desperate because you realize you've been in the wrong for the last 4 or 5 years. But whatever the deal is, it's like, you know, do you just like let that slide? You just say, oh, okay, welcome to the party. Or you just be like, wait a second. I remember the time you tried to get so-and-so canceled, and you tried this, and you tried that, and you tried, you know.
Yeah. Unless I see a, it's going to take a lot more than just a change of the agenda and the narrative. For me, I'm going to have to see a flat out apology.
Oh, that'll never flat happen. Out.
Yeah. And that'll never happen.
That'll never happen.
So, yeah, as far as it goes with in terms of, you know, the forgiveness factor and whatever, you know, I don't really believe in holding on to things like hate or whatever, because it only eats you up alive. But in terms of actually going like, oh, yeah, whatever, I'll forget about it. You know, everything's cool. Like, you guys are seeing the light now, maybe, kind of. Yeah, sure, I'll come. It's like, no. You could do what you're going to do, and, you know, best to you, but that bridge has been burned. June, what's up? Says, this is live. Yes, it's live. Thank you for the super chat, too. But, yeah, it's the stuff that went down, especially, like, oh, my Lord, they went about ruining people's lives, and and I had personal experience with a lot of that.
Yes.
And I don't necessarily want to walk down memory lane as far as that goes, but it's ridiculous. And especially when it was happening around the first, I'd say maybe between 2016 to 2018 in full swing, it was so new to people, and no one really knew how to take this, and it was just this life-ending sort of feeling that would come over a lot of people. But now it's kind of like the same playbook over and over again, and you just see it and you yawn half the time, you know?
Yeah, I think, you know, that's what I was talking about. It seemed like a lot of people were caught off guard at how quickly everything changed. I don't think we realized, you know, how, I mean, I hate to use the word infected, but like how infected the media had become, the comic book media had become. And then you start to see that there were people working in the companies and working in the PR departments and stuff. And they were all kind of, you know, colluding, for lack of a better word, to try to paint the vast majority of comic book readers as being these awful, you know, bigot Nazis or whatever the hell the narrative was. And anybody who spoke out against that was, you know, stomped down. And you know, it took a while, I think, for us to see that it really was a handful of people. It was a handful of people pulling the strings, and it just seemed like there were more people that were angry and upset because of social media. And the people that were kind of pulling the strings, I think, were, you know, they had some clout. They, you know, they were working for websites, or that, you know, they were editors or whatever the deal was. It just seemed like the entire world hated, you know, anybody who spoke out. And that was the point. I had a conversation with Troy Leavitt from the lead on Hogwarts Legacy last week. We had him on. And, you know, we talked about the playbook and how you would get like three or four journalists and they would decide that this is what the narrative for the week is going to be. This is the person we're going to single out. And we're all going to write articles, and then we're all going to cite each other, and then we're going to repost it to social media, and then we're going to get all of our buddies on social media to
pull this thing up. Yeah, they're taking cues from big mainstream media.
Right, and then next thing you know, it seems like the entire world is out to get you, but it literally is a tempest in a teapot, because you go out to these fan events where you see, you know, maybe canceled people are showing up, and they get huge turnouts, you know, because the vast majority of fans still are pretty sane. They're pretty normal. It's just that they've been drowned out by all the crazies online.
Yeah. And, you know. I mean, it's like anything else. The loudest side of whatever is such a small percentage, but they're so loud that they make you think that there's so much more of them than there is. And the same thing works within the way these media companies go down, you know, and then whoever they're owned by too, because this largely isn't a lot of independent media, but even those that were working within more forms of independent media, not hugely corporate owned kind of subdivisions, would go about it and try to get this clout and hopefully earn a step up. You know, and it's the same thing that's played out in larger aspects across the world with so many other companies, media, etc. And this has been a story that's been going on for a long time. These kind of tactics are decades old, if not longer. Ever since you got a newspaper or any kind of for-profit news media industry propped up, you've had stuff like this. So, you know, it's not necessarily surprising, but I think in our corner of the world that seemed so removed from that kind of nonsense and weirdness, when it dropped like a ton of bricks, I think it really took people for a spin.
Yeah, because you know, here's the thing, like geeks, you know, we're used to being the outcast, we're used to being ignored. And I think when nerd culture went Hollywood, you know, when the superhero movie started making a ton of money at the box office, even though the comic books weren't doing that great, there was this big spotlight shone on our corner of the internet, our corner of the world. And all of a sudden it became valuable real estate. You know, you had to control that, because if you control the comic book scene, the tabletop scene, the whatever, the anime scene, then, you know, you kind of steer the ship of where pop culture is going. So it was very valuable. And I think it's calculated. I think there are absolutely people behind the scenes that are like, okay, well, the next big thing is anime, so let's start, you know, demonizing anime fans right out of the gate, because we know we got to be there, and we got to control this. And, you know, and we saw some attempts to do that, you know, not long after, you know, comic book fans were getting smeared. And you know, once the novelty wears off, I'm starting to wonder now if we're not gonna see a lot of this drama cool down, because the comic book movies aren't doing so well at the box office. So it might not be worth it to go after comic book fans or try to control that.
Yeah, like maybe Hollywood doesn't look like quite as viable an option, especially right now with the strikes that are going on and everything that's happening with AI and all that other stuff. But yeah, so they'll leave damage alone done again, for so many.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, people lost their jobs. People were harassed. I mean, I know, again, not to go down there, but you were put in the crosshairs. Just so much of just a massive overreaction. I mean, I've never.
Oh, yeah.
It was just insane. It wasn't just like, hey, we're angry that these people are saying mean things about our friends' comic books. It was like, we literally are plotting to destroy you completely, utterly, you know, over.
Well, yeah, yeah.
Comic books. Well, especially, you know, comic books.
Especially, it's so crazy. At that time, back in 2018. And man, you know, honestly, it's almost 5 years ago exactly to the day, now that I think about it. Holy smokes. Because it was late August when it happened in 2018. And it was almost like, if you don't pick up these torches and pitchforks and march with us and burn down that house and kill these people, it was like that mentality. If you don't join us in stringing these people up, we're coming after you. And I was like, I don't think we should string these people up. Like, this is ridiculous, you know? And especially, I'm just out here thanking fans. That's how it all started. And they're like, well, are you aware of the kinds of people? And it's like, what are you talking about? You know? And the way that went down, and then especially I compounded it by coming out with the whole opinion on the block list situation.
Oh, yeah, that was crazy.
Which is going to be hilarious if Elon Musk removes the ability to block.
It's like, was it worth it? All that for a drop gracious. Of blood, right?
Yeah, you know, and it's like, it's very silly looking back on it, you know, because time does manage to heal some of these things. And if you don't let it kind of, if you become so ensconced in it, I think you end up doing far more damage to you than what's originally done in the beginning. So you do have to move on. You got to find a way. You can't just define, well, I mean, some people do define themselves as a victim for forever, but you can't define yourself as a victim for forever. Then they really win. You know, so you do have to find a way. Okay, that sucks. It happened, you know, and you got to move on, pick up the pieces. But for me, it was always the worst part of it. I could care less about, you know, Joe Rando on the internet within the industry or whoever they sent after or anything. It was the people that they had convinced, which was the people I had known in some cases for about 10 years, to go after and say, you know, oh, my Lord, you're that way. Wow. You know, I must have not known. And I'm like, no, you didn't know because I'm not that way. I'm not the things they're saying that I am, you know. And instead of those people, you expect them to go, hey, he's not that way. What is this nonsense? You know, our readers aren't that way. What are you talking about? I make this kind of book and my readers have always been great and respectful. And why would you say these horrible things about them? Instead of standing up and having some inkling of a spine, you know, to see some of these people, about a dozen or so, turn tail and not just crap on me, but crap on their readers too in the process. I was like, wow, what is this nonsense? That's the stuff that really was hitting me. And people coming out of the woodwork, because I made a lot of enemies over the years being a publisher and rejecting thousands of submissions. So it was one of those things where, you know, I wasn't quite aware of just exactly how many people still had an axe to grind. So it was crazy times.
You know, weirdly enough, I brought this up before, you rejected us. And yet here we are, we're still talking.
Look at that, you know, because you're a normal, rational human being.
No, actually, it's true. We submitted Shadowbinders. We were going to rework it as a comic. But I mean, you basically said, you know, it's not a good fit for Alterna. And I agree with that, because the way we tell our stories, it probably isn't, because I don't think we can take our stuff and condense it down into a smaller format. We do the graphic novel format.
Yeah, because I was trying to get away from that format at the time.
Right, which, you know, I didn't know, but I mean, I wasn't mad. I mean, it's just like, people don't understand. Like, sometimes you get a rejection, it's not because there's anything necessarily wrong with your work. Sometimes it's just like, it doesn't fit the publishing schedule. It's not right for the audience. There are numbers that go into it. I mean, there's so many things that go into it. you know, and and it's just like you knock on doors, and sometimes you get lucky. Sometimes you can knock on the same door two different times, and it's you're going to get a different answer. And I've had that happen before. I've actually knocked on a door, and they're like, "Oh no, we're not interested in that." And then like 2 years later, "Oh yeah, now we're interested in that because that's where we're going right now." And you just happen to be there with the right thing when they need it. So, I mean, I would tell people not, you know, with any kind of rejection too, like don't take that personally, and sure as hell do not fume about it for years. I mean, I've had a couple of stories that there were some like dirty deeds involved in, but that's a little bit different. If it's just a case of like you're submitting your stuff and the publisher's like, "Hey, it's just not a good fit for us," or whatever, then just okay, that door's shut. Yeah. Move on to the next thing.
At the end of the day, too, and I've talked about this before, so in the chat, if you've heard me talk about this ad nauseum, forgive me. But at the end of the day, regardless of the situation of how the rejection comes about, you don't want to be there anyway. Trust me. You know, even if it's a shady thing that has occurred or some kind of blacklist, you don't want to be there anyway. So you're dodging a bullet, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's just it's one of those things. And comics is such a small industry too. Like, you don't want to make any more enemies than you have to. And that's, I think, what kind of blindsided a lot of people with all the drama going online, is just like, you know, until 2015, 2016, you know, there were people that didn't like each other very much, but it wasn't like we had, you know, tribes of people. And that was what was so damn weird about it. Like, you had people that didn't like each other very much. Maybe if you go to a convention, you wouldn't want to sit next to them. You wouldn't want to be on a panel with them. You don't stop by their table, whatever, you know.
Yeah, it was just handled in a civil way.
It was handled in a civil way for the most part, you know.
Yeah.
And then it just became this, you know, tribalism, which was so damn weird. I mean, it caught me off guard because at that point, I'd already decided I wasn't going to do comics anymore. I'm like, I'm done. Like, it doesn't pay. And the last work I did some Disney work for IDW and Fantagraphics, and I'm like, yeah, I'm done after this, because as much as I enjoy it, at that same time I could be doing, because I do web development, so I'm like, I could do web development and make a lot more money and not have to deal with the headaches. And it seems like I'm looking at this situation, I'm like, this well is definitely drying up. And this was back in like 2014, 2015. I'm like, yeah, the end is near. Like, the page rates aren't as good as they used to be. I'm seeing kind of a dead end here for, you know, at least the mainstream industry.
It's funny because both the rise of indies being able to be self-sufficient with crowdfunding and selling direct, and that becoming a far more viable, if not profitable, way to do it than the traditional road, whether it was through a publisher or independently through distribution, that and the rise of access media really just... they had to do whatever they had to do to maintain the status quo in terms of getting what they were getting, so they could keep operating and getting advertising and everything else coming in. Yeah. Those hit at the same time. And I think that created that perfect storm of this shockwave, this reaction, this knee-jerk kind of response to all of a sudden, wait a second. Between the access media not really being as prevalent as it was before, because social media was so on the rise, you could just get right access to your readers. And there's a reader review is worth 100 comic website reviews. And I've noticed that, and that's quantifiable for me specifically. Mm-hmm. We could like back with Newsarama, we could have got a review on there, and it didn't do anything. It didn't do anything. But if you have a reader out there that's like, I got the books, I love the books, and they're posting pictures, they're talking about it, that always meant something. And we saw both of those things really hit. And the response to that by people who felt obviously like they couldn't compete or they were being threatened in some way, shape, or form indirectly, they responded. And their response was to try to destroy that which they could not compete with.
Yeah, it was really weird because... you know, I think with comic book reviews, especially if you depend on getting comps, and that's a whole thing. It's just like, you know, video game websites or whatever. You get comps and you get access. If you say anything overly negative, you're not going to get access anymore. You know, I know this. I was a professional Disney blogger for years. I think a lot of people that follow us know that. And I was not allowed to be truthful. Like, they would whine us and dine us, and, you know, we'd talk about everything was the best thing ever. I know I gave some... my wife talks about this because she was floored. I gave some lukewarm criticism about Toy Story Land when they opened it, and I was threatened to be removed from the invite list. I said it was too hot because they didn't have enough shade. That's it. I said, hey, the coaster's great. The food's not bad. It's a nice addition to the park. I had a lot of fun. Thanks, Disney, for bringing me in. But
wow,
it's a little too hot. It's a little too hot because it's Florida and it's all concrete and there's no shade.
Such a mean, and, controversial take.
It was. From you. And I gave it like a B plus, I think. And because of that, I got a phone call. I said, well, you know, this sounds kind of negative. This could be interpreted in a negative fashion. Didn't they, like, 6 months later, put some damn umbrellas up in Toy Story Land? Because a lot of people complained about that. But it's the same thing. You lose access, there goes your content.
It's like, no, it's better you have a lawsuit because people are passing out from heat stroke.
Right. But no, it's the same thing with the comics. It's the same thing with the video games. It's movies, all that. It's a game you play if you're doing it for profit and you're... views depend on, you know, getting access to the latest, greatest, or getting the interviews, or getting the whatever. You're going to have to play ball, and playing ball means, you know, you don't tell the truth all the time, because you can't. I mean, that's just so you get social media in there, and you get, you know, just your average reader picking up a book and saying, hey, this is crap, or I hate this thing so much, I'm going to rip it out and throw it out the window. Oh my God, that is literally killing somebody. That is because that just completely fries their circuits. And that's really, you know, what it all came down to. I mean, you can try to, you know, say it's about politics. You can try to say it's about whatever. It was about fear. It was about the fact that the old guard, both publishers and the media, were being replaced in real time. They knew they were. And they were freaking out. They were just absolutely freaking out. Same thing happened with crowdfunding. When, I don't know if you remember, but when Kickstarter first came on the scene, Fantagraphics, actually, it was the Comics Journal, they put this thing out about e-begging and how it wasn't really publishing. If you had to, you know, publish your stuff yourself through like Kickstarter, that's just e-begging, and it's not really publishing. It doesn't count unless you've actually gone through a publisher. And then like 2 years later, Fantagraphics is on the skids, and they have to go to Kickstarter to survive. You know, it's just... And are they ever going to apologize? You ever going to see them apologize?
The money isn't really money. The product isn't really product, you know. Right, everybody in the chat, you guys that back crowdfunding campaigns, it's magical money. It's magic. It's like Monopoly money, you know. It's not real money. It's not money that you earned in any way, shape, or form and spent it in the same capacity you spend anything else on. It's all fake. I mean, that's really... I've heard a lot of theories for the simulated reality. But that's a new one that they're popping up there. You know, it's not real. It's not the real thing. It's not the same. It's not a published book.
It's not a published book.
It's not real money from real people.
It's like, no, because actually the people that are self-publishing their books are probably making more money. There's more money in their pockets than if they go through some of these publishers, you know. It's just bizarre. Just the mental gymnastics. And really, it's just... It seems like the lower you go, the harder people fight for scraps, you know?
Yeah.
That's what it feels like. It feels like the comic book industry right now, this is a personal opinion. And look, there are some good people that work in the comic book industry. There are some books out there I actually think are pretty decent. But we have a lot of people just fighting over the scraps of what was the Western comic book industry. And they're staring down the barrel of a gun called manga. You know, they're staring down the barrel of a gun called just the tastes are changing. Kids are changing. They haven't done a lot. I mean, for all this talk about, you know, kids want to read. Let's get kids reading comics. I don't see them really being successful at that. You know, I think the distribution model's broken. I mean, I could go on and on, but
there's so many facets of it. And again, I don't want to beat this zombified horse into the ground. Yeah. Any further than we already have in some capacity.
There's nothing left to say, really. I mean, it's been covered to death. It's over.
There's every aspect of it. There's parts of it that are so broken to the point that you can't fix them. You just can't. It's impossible. They're way too interdependent, and they're all cogs in this unbelievably weird, just falling off the wheels wagon that's pulling along the comic industry as if it's still around in any capacity that makes any sense. And it's been like that for quite some time, unfortunately. But that's the reason that we left distribution, because there was no reason to stay. Yep. To stay in that system made no sense. And if we stayed for longer than we were there, literally just to wait out the pandemic, that response that had happened, because we left in April 2020, if we had waited it out, and I waited out like the 8 or 9 months when they said we were going to get paid and we just stopped putting out books and everything else, there would be no Alterna Comics. We had to shift immediately. And luckily enough, we were able to do that because we were selling direct for so long because of the Diamond screw-ups. And if Diamond didn't screw up for like 2 years on all of our reorders, I don't think we would have been selling direct. So we would have been put in a pretty tough situation at that point to just knee-jerk reaction, boom, go right into it. So in some capacity, I do have to thank them for screwing up and putting me down a path that was that, okay, well, got to start selling direct because we can't keep losing thousands of reorders. And then now here we are, and we're still around.
That was insane. That whole thing, like, I mean, that just shows how fragile the comic book industry is. That if Diamond says, hey, you know what, we're just going to nope out for a couple of months. You know, we're just going to crawl under the desk in the fetal position. You know, the comic book industry will still be here when we get back. But the fact that everybody was so dependent on them, because it shouldn't matter. It should have been a speed bump for most companies, especially a company like, you know, DC or Marvel or whatever, that, you know, they're owned by a bigger company. It should have just been like, oh, well, that sucks. Well, I guess we're going to just step over you, which they did eventually. But like, it broke everything.
Yeah.
It just broke people. And everybody's like, oh, quick, put the pencils down. Everybody, panic mode. We don't know what to do without Diamond. I'm like, God, there used to be alternatives to Diamond. Like when I was big into reading comics in the 90s, we had a couple different distributors. But you guys are so dependent on this one thing. I mean, talk about one horse town, right?
And I don't know the legality of the situation in terms of how their contracts were laid out. Ours was a non-exclusive. I never signed an exclusive with a distributor. And so we were able to do what we did to sell. I mean, they didn't like it. They would constantly go, you're going to cannibalize your sales through Diamond. And I'm like, it doesn't matter because you guys don't send us those purchase orders when we lose like 1,000 reorders every month anyway. So, you know, I'll take the risk. We'll cannibalize those sales. So at the expense of giving them like 62% of what the cover price was, I look at that with the publishers that were involved, and if they had anything, I know that some of them had an exclusive deal, but I wonder in that scenario if they could have been like, look, if you're not going to distribute product, our contract is basically null and void at this point in time, you know, so we have to get product out there. So they should have all, if they were able to, get some kind of distribution division up and running and then just sell comics direct, ship them out, and build towards that. And at the very least, within a year's time, maybe do that, because everything is so bureaucratic in a corporate system. So it takes forever to do something like that. But that should have been for everyone. It should have spelled that, wow, you know, at any point in time, this is all just going to fall and collapse. And it's funny because now I think we're seeing so many of these publishers. I mean, Image, I think, was the last one I can think of that had left. Diamond. I wish they would all set up their own direct distribution. But you know, it's still remarkable that I don't think I don't think Dark Horse either. Dark Horse, maybe what, IDW? Do they still distribute through Diamond? Are they even still around?
Simon Schuster, that was a thing, and then they just got
and sold. Then Simon Schuster,
So it's like, I mean, I don't understand. I don't understand the logic of how it works or why people thought this was a good idea. Now, the weird thing is before all the internet drama, there were actually people that were on the other side of it during the drama that were calling this out. Jude Terror, I remember, he wrote an article. I want to say it was 2011, 2012. It was called "The Comic Book Industry is Burning Down and I'm Playing the Fiddle" or something like that. And he actually got into it with Heidi McDonald about the state, the very things we've been talking about the last couple of years. And, you know, it's so weird to see Bleeding Cool on the other side of it when they were calling this stuff out like 10 years ago. They're like, yeah, the comic book industry is going to totally break. It's going to collapse. It's going to take us for Diamond to get taken out. And that's going to be it. And, they were calling it out and they got called out, and I guarantee you Jude Terror back in the day would have been called Comics Gate if that term existed back then. But then again, Bleeding Cool wound up on the other side of it, which I thought was so damn weird.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I mean, largely, I'd say most of the Comics Gate talk, it really shifted towards, it played out the way everything plays out in the entire world. It turned into social justice issues. It turned into this other thing, a complete straw man arguments the entire way. When it was about industry practices, bad writing, bad art, and mistreatment of the customer. You know, and it was like top to bottom, those three, four things, whatever, those were very important to discuss and very important for everybody to address in some capacity of understanding, look, this is not a good road to go down. We don't want to go down this road. It's not going to end well for us. And instead it shifted real fast to just hone in on a couple of inflammatory type statements from people who were having it out with others who also were making just as, if not worse, equally inflammatory statements. And instead of this microcosm of a thing between a conversation of individuals, it just poured gas on that fire. And it turned into like, set up the straw man and keep burning them. And that, to this day, even, it's still that. But it's like, if anything, though, you ask everybody about what's happening in the comics industry, you'll be surprised how many people that would be so vehemently anti Comics Gate or whatever are having like 90 to 95% of the same talking points about what's happening within the industry. And yet no one still wants to discuss it or touch it, no matter what. And it's like, that's what's happening. It's concrete. It's there.
Yeah, it was really weird because it was like, I mean, you would see these debates or whatever, and they would always degenerate into some political discussion, right? And it's like, you take the politics out of the situation, right? Like, don't talk, like, we try to take it out and just look at the numbers and just be like, look, I don't care what your politics are, right? Yeah. We got people, both camps, you know, that are suffering badly because the comic book industry is in terrible shape. And people have been all over the board politically for years. It just never became such a divisive issue until recently, you know, but it was just so weird how something that should be apolitical, that should just be like, hey, the comic book industry is burning down. What are we going to do? And we've had lots business. Of journalists. Yeah, even you know, Heidi McDonald, she used to write articles about how little graphic novelists were getting paid. They were getting like $10,000 a year, and they were expected to work like 2 or 3 years on a book. And you know, just the poverty wages that people were working, all of a sudden now it was like, well, let's you know, stick it to the people making money on crowdfunding now because we don't like their politics. You know, I'm like, that's counterproductive. I mean, if nothing else, you should be learning. Like, hey, if they did it, maybe I can do it too.
Yeah, yeah. Get immediately, you know, on the side of the corporation, because the corporation is now dressing up a character in a certain way and treating skin color, ethnicity, sexuality like it's a costume change. You know, get on the side of the corporation because of that. Even though we all know full well how the industry works, and that when the movie rolls along, back to the status quo.
Yeah,
so it's, you know.
Yeah, pretty
man,
much.
Oh man,
I think the reason that the changes are being allowed right now, I mean, my personal opinion is the comic books don't matter.
Yep.
It doesn't matter. You can do whatever you want to do. The X-Men, when the movie comes out, we're going to do whatever we want to do with the X-Men. We'll just reset it. And, you know, guess what? Iceman's straight again. Because that's, you know, that's what we're doing. Or we're just going to sidestep that whole issue. Because we can't.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, once they kind of started making reboots and retcons kind of the norm, and then when the copyright situation kind of comes up, where all of a sudden they're staring that in the face, and they're going, well, we got to start creating something that's sort of the same, but a derivative of. You know, what better thing to do than to create this facade and use it? It's horrible because it's using people as these shields for business
decisions.
That's
exactly what it is. Yeah.
Yeah. It's all money at the end. They don't care about people in this capacity. It's not representation. The representation is the dumbest thing I ever heard of when it comes to the fictional and the aspect of storytelling, because it should just be, first of all, diversity is a given. I have never read a single comic book in my entire life where I couldn't point out that there was diversity among the pages, whether it was especially among the personalities or whatever, or the individuals superficially. there was always some kind of diverse element, or especially the content. But then to sit there and say that there needs to be a representation element to it, all I could think of is like, well, get rid of all of it. Get rid of all of it. Because now we're talking about creating nonfiction. You know, you can't have aliens. You can't have talking anthropomorphic animals. You can't have superheroes, for crying out loud, either, because who the hell do they represent? Are there superheroes running around right now? I mean, I'm not seeing a hell of a lot of them, but okay. You know, so once you start going down that road of these people that, okay, superficially they represent you because maybe they share a skin color or whatever else. Man, like, what a weird road to go down. That's just preaching that these are the things that are important and that matter, and not the person underneath, not the content of character. And that, to me, was something that I loved about comic books, because comic books really featured and showcased content of character. And sometimes you didn't like the content of the character, and it was a villain or a character that you know was going to butt heads with another one because the personalities were different. But it was great because it showcased all of that. And then once you start saying that that doesn't really matter, it's the superficial that matters. What a weird thing to preach.
Yeah, it's so weird. You want to know what they actually think. You want to know what they actually think of you. Look at the strikes. Look at what's going on in Hollywood. Look at how they're divesting themselves of their DEI officers, how quickly they're pivoting because the money's not there. That's what they really think. You know, it's a corporation. I mean, they're going to do what's profitable. The reason they chased diversity and inclusion is it was a talking point for years. Now the public is kind of burnt out on it because it's been overdone. It's been over, you know, shoved in your face. It's become this big issue, talking about whatever. Now that the flavor of the month has changed, they are pivoting at a shocking rate. I mean, I mean, it's just unreal. Hollywood's just like, oh yeah, diversity officer, you're gone. Like, all these studios got rid of their people within the course of a month, because the flavor of the month has changed. The shows are getting canceled even before the strikes. Most of them would be considered like diverse shows. I mean, I'm just saying, like, these were shows for a very limited audience that led with, look at who's making the show, look at, you know, the makeup, the cast, the ethnic makeup, the sexual identities of the characters. That's our story. The sexual identity of the characters are our story.
The bingo card is full, you know, right. And they're still shelving them.
And you want to know what they actually think. That's, there it is, right there. They're telling you what they think. Do I think that's going to hit comics? I think comics is kind of the last thing that's going to get hit, because it doesn't make money. These comics don't make money. It's the marketing tools.
I mean, specifically, we can see it really play out in real time with Marvel and Disney, because you see that 5-year plan, and every single time that 5-year plan rolled out, because 2009, I believe, was the acquisition, if I remember correctly. And so you see that 5-year plan roll out, 2014 rolls around, big, weird changes start to occur.
Yes.
And then 2019 rolls around at the end of that 5-year plan, and all of a sudden Disney seems like, you know what? We gave you a shot. We're done. You know, so now we're coming in and we're going to do what we got to do. We're going to see, I think, a real big shift by 2024 and into 2025 and beyond. I think we're going to see a very different looking comic book industry, especially as far as Marvel is concerned.
The rest
of the industry is going to follow suit.
It's going to be in shambles. And, you know, I still have to wonder in the back of my mind, like, how long until they decide it just makes more sense just to outsource all the comics, you know, because it doesn't make sense to have a publishing house and have to deal with these people and deal with editors you can't control, writers you can't control. I mean, are they really, they're writing stuff whole cloth now, like for the Disney Plus shows and the movies. Like, did they really need to have these people on staff?
It just go into even reprints, you know. They got. Oh my lord! How many decades?
Of material, you know. They haven't even scratched the surface yet. They haven't even adapted 0.5% of all the Marvel comics that have been published.
Yeah, the character catalog, the issues. I mean, there's books there that I'm not even close to being aware of.
Yeah, I mean, especially you get back into, like, the 70s, and there was some weird stuff in the 70s. But, like, there were all kinds of crazy books I was going through the quarter bins. I'm like, man, what is this? I've never even heard of this. I didn't even realize this character had a series or whatever. And there's so much that they could adapt, you know. So they really don't need, because they're not gonna stick to the comics anyway. They're gonna take, I mean, look at, you know, Civil War and look at Infinity Gauntlet, and they're gonna take the basic outline of the story and then they're gonna Hollywood it up or work with the characters that they have the rights to and
absolutely, you know,
do what they can do. So they really don't need new ideas.
It's the equivalent of you've purchased a gold mine and all you want to do is use the gold to I don't even know, man, make just sell jewelry. And it's like you even know about all the other applications you could do with gold that are going to make you far more money than just turning it into trinkets. You know, like you get the coal mined and purchase it for just charcoal briquettes, you know, like that is the equivalent of that. And so they've got this IP mine where they don't, it's like the comic book side of it. Give me a break. They get one half decent movie out in a year and it makes what that entire comic book division made in that entire year.
Yeah, so I think it's just kind of the perfect storm of, you know, why did things happen the way that they happened? And I think it was politics that was the kind of, you know, what lit the keg on fire, I think. But it was already, there was already a lot of, I think, underlying fear. I think there was already, you know, a lot of people were already disgruntled because they saw the industry shifting. Like I said, I left in 2014, 2015, because I'm like, I don't think there's a future in this. You know, and I know before we start talking about the state of the comic book industry, I talked to my wife and I'm like, you know, are we sure we're done? Because if we talk about this, we're done. We're like 100% done. Like if we talk about our experiences in the industry, honestly, we're never going to be invited to anything. They're going to call us all kinds of names. It's over. So we talked about it for like a week before we actually started talking about, like, and I think what got us into it was the lawsuit with Mark Waid, because that was just a massive,
oh my
ridiculous
Lord
situation.
Yeah.
And you know, we talked about that and it's like, yeah, as soon as we say something. So immediately after that, we had like all these people I used to work with that I was following on Twitter. They all unfollowed me, blocked me, whatever, because they were afraid of getting the cooties. And I'm like, joke's on you, pal. I already quit. Like, you can't take anything from me because I already quit the comic book industry. I don't give a shit. I'm making way more money doing everything else I'm doing.
Yeah, you're literally over there like everything Hermie the Elf, man. You can't fire
right?
me.
Like,
I quit.
Yeah, literally everything else I'm doing pays more than comics. And I had already walked away from the industry at that point. So I'm like, just freaking burn the bridge behind me, I guess. Might as well say my piece and, you know.
It's like, oh no, I can't be the cover band for the rest of my comic book career.
Yeah,
what
right
will I do?
It's like, whatever. Whatever.
I guess I'll just have to create all my own characters and own all of them and be able to fully maximize the ability to do so. Oh no. It's doomed for me.
Can you imagine what Twitter would have been like if it existed when Image Comics happened?
Oh my Lord. Yeah, they would have been, whoo. That would have been an ugly scene.
I mean, it was. I don't think people remember, like, I'm old enough to remember reading, you know, Wizard magazine back in the day, and Peter, I'm sure you were too, but like, there was so much salt from the people that were left behind, basically. The people that were left behind at DC and Marvel, because these guys, they're top guys, they just all left at once. And they're like, yep, we're out of here. We're going to go do our own thing. It's like, nobody's going to buy your stupid Batman knockoff comic, Todd McFarlane. Who do you think you are? Spider-Man made you. Yeah, he's living in a cardboard box now. I think that cardboard box is probably worth about $10 million. You know, dude's got $3 million baseball. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely. Man,
and then,
oh man.
Then now he's got the license for the DC Comics action figures.
Irony, man. That is just, yeah. I can't even wrap my head around how weird that is to just see that kind of thing.
Yeah, yeah.
All those Image guys, though, in some capacity, for the most part, I'd say maybe half of the Image guys went and turned around and started working back again at the corporate side of it. I mean, I wish they didn't. But it is ironic that they are. I mean, you get Jim Lee, who's practically running DC, and that is just strange. So it's what a weird industry it's been for 30 years. And these are things that have been set in motion for 30 or so years. These are not things that happened, you know, in the past 5 to 10 even. Every single thing that's occurred has been occurring over this kind of time period here. NXR, thank you so much for the super chat. Says, hey, Neon, finally I can message you directly. I've been trying to bring a fan work to your attention. He-Man Boar by BWWD.
I don't know.
I wish I could help you out with that.
I appreciate it. I'll have to look into it. I don't have the rights to He-Man, though. You know, I don't know if I wish I did at this point, but I don't have the rights to He-Man, so I can't really do anything.
Yeah. I'm, Goodness gracious. Oh, looks like we got a really awful person in the chat.
Oh, no, in a comics chat? Really?
Yeah. Oh, my well.
God.
Have fun making another account. Banned.
Friend of yours.
I guess so. Maybe. I have no idea. You know? I mean, I saw them kind of trolling around through and whatever and saying some, but it's like, get that crap out of here. All right. So, and oddly enough, you know what the kind of person that is? That's the person that says that we're those kinds of people. Isn't that always the case?
I don't get that. I mean, we try to. It's so weird. Like, people say that we're, like, overly political and stuff. I don't think we are. I really don't think we are. I think we've tried to stay pretty even keel. I mean, I always consider myself a liberal. I don't even consider myself a conservative. You know, I'm an old school liberal. Like I said, the goalposts have moved. And things have changed. The weird thing is that the majority of people working in the comic book industry were probably, you know, we probably aligned in our ideology for the most part for a number of years. And I think a lot of people still do. They're just, especially the older people, they're just afraid to say anything. You know, I think it's going to come out after the fact, though. I think it's just going to be like with Image, with Todd McFarlane making DC action figures, where in 10 years from now, nobody's going to remember this, except for the people, unfortunately, that had to deal with all the drama. And they'll be like, yeah, I remember about 10 years ago, 15 years ago, there are these like crazies that tried to get us banned from conventions and tried to get, you know, they tried to get people fired and they're threatening violence and, you know, but it's all going to go away and it's all just going to be, you know, whatever comics is then. I think comics is going to look very different, obviously. But
yeah, again, I think all that stuff is such a straw man. It's such a different thing. Just let's talk about anything but the situation at hand. Talk about anything but the problems that we could possibly fix, you know, and let's just focus on that. And I'll even invent something to accuse you of so that may you, everyone around, is talking about that as opposed to, well, you know, maybe comic distribution really is broken. Maybe the publishers are, yeah.
You know, they said it before us. The people on the other side, they were all saying the exact same thing. Yeah. They just didn't have the political bent to it, but they've all been saying the same
thing. Maybe the reboots are bad. Maybe the yes. constant shakeup in the storytelling and things have gone really downhill. And maybe the price of the comics is so, you know, getting through the roof because the distribution and the economy of scale isn't there. Maybe. You know? Maybe. And then you took them off of the newsstand, so the advertising is, you know, down the plunker. You know, all of these different things to talk about. Maybe we should talk about the retailers and the fact that, you know, why don't you set up those stores so it's really accessible for some customer to walk in and find something nice and easy based on genre of book. Because when they walk in and they don't know what the hell a comic book is for the most part, and they're just looking for whatever, alphabetizing publishers isn't going to help. Alphabetizing the titles isn't going to help. That doesn't mean anything to anybody. Alterna is the same publisher as Image or Dark Horse. You know, if you don't know what the heck the comic book is that you're looking yep. for, doesn't matter to you. But you know what you like. You know you're into horror or sci-fi or fantasy or adventure or action or romance or whatever. You know, talk about anything that could actually lead towards something productive and positive of an outcome within the industry. But nah, let's not do that. Instead, let's just be at each other's throats. And anybody that says something wrong, let's all of a sudden say that they're the worst person imaginable. That's so productive.
That blew my mind. Like, okay, so when there was this big power, do you remember that conversation? I can't remember that guy's channel. There was a comic book retailer. He had a channel. He's got like a pig or something for his avatar. Dan, I don't know. Anyway, he had this round table. He had like Steve Jeppy and I don't know who else was there. I think Mike Richardson from Dark Horse, I think, was there. Was it Mike Richards? Yeah. I don't know. The guys from, there were a bunch of publishers, Steve Jeppy, they were in a room together, and it was a perfect opportunity to talk about the problems in the comic book industry. And this guy was so distracted because Zach showed up in his chat. He didn't say anything. He just dared show up. And this guy, like, lost his shit.
Dan Shaheen?
Yeah. That guy. And he just, like, completely lost his shit. And I'm like, God, why does it bother you so much? If he's not doing it, he's just here to listen. Why does it bother you so much? You know, I mean, that could have been a watershed moment. That could have been, like, everybody could actually sit down and freak in. Because you had, like, Heidi McDonald was there. And you had Rich Johnson was there. I was there for about 20 minutes until I realized it was going to be what it was going to be, where he just, like, lost his freaking shit. And can I say that on your channel? I say that on
my channel. You've said it quite a bit.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't know if I was allowed to or not.
Well, I'll tolerate that. You know, we'll play PG-13 with that, you know? Okay. Yeah.
All right,
we'll
I'm sorry. It's a force of habit. So we're a little spicy over on that.
It's tough. It's tough when it's a topic that stirs the emotion. The thing too, and I don't even know if Dan Shaheen is he still talking to people? Is he still doing
it? I have no idea. This is a couple of years ago. I watched that one and I was like, okay, this is good. Everybody's sitting down talking. Maybe we can come up with a solution. Maybe we can have some people sit down and actually talk about the situation. No, that's not what happened. Because some people, they don't want a solution. They don't want peace or a truce or a workable situation. They want drama. They want to be victims. They want to be the good guys when maybe they're not so good. Yeah, everybody thinks they're the hero, right? Everybody always thinks they're the... I think I'm the good guy. I'm probably not a very good guy. Depends on who you ask, but, you know, everybody thinks they're the hero of their own story, right? And I just think people need to sit down and talk about the damn situation. Be like, look, the comic book industry is burning down. We're in crisis mode. And, you know, what the hell are we going to do about it? But then a lot of people that are complaining the most don't really have a dog in this fight, do they? Because they're just work for hire. They don't actually own.
Yeah. Well, I think we're seeing the response now. I mean, certainly from myself and many others at this point, it's turned into, yeah, whatever. You know what? At this point, do what you want to do.
Yeah, pretty much. You know, I mean, if you burn it down, there's nothing left for you then either, right? But I'm like, it seems like the publishers are starting to come around. Like, you know, you've got Boom out there doing crowdfunding now. So crowdfunding is more acceptable. I remember they tried to bully Boom into canceling their crowdfunders. And then they were supposed to pay reparations, I guess. You know, when they had a couple $1 million on the Keanu Reeves book, Berserker. And everybody started guilting them. Like, well, they only paid me $50 a page 5 years ago for this completely unrelated project. So now you got to give me more money because you made money on Kickstarter, right? And but yeah, they just kind of held the line there too. So I think publishers are gonna have to push back and be like, either we get rid of some of these people or we rein them in or something, because nobody's doing well. You can't, other than some of the people working in the indie space, nobody's doing well. So don't even lie.
I think at this point too, largely those decisions are going to end up being made for them in some capacity, at least at some of the publishers. Now I want to really shift gears. We only have 2 minutes. I know you said an hour.
Yeah, a little bit. We can go a couple minutes longer than that.
Okay, so all right. Let's go another 15. Is that okay with you? Another 15 minutes?
We'll do 15 more minutes. Yeah.
Okay. All right. So now I want to shift gears a bit. I want to be talking about what you guys have been up to creatively. You know, we covered, and please, guys in the chat, I know you've enjoyed the conversation tonight, but it's been a couple of years since we've caught up, so we're just kind of like, so sorry
pretty
about
much.
That,
much.
If that's the case. So what have you guys been up to? You guys been doing so much between your YouTube channel, between your website, between your comics. You've got all kinds of other stuff going on. What's the story?
Well, okay, so a lot of what we're working on, nobody's seen yet, and we can't really talk about yet. I can talk about stuff that people have seen. We finally got our Crimson Wren books in. Look at that.
Hold on. Let me get you full scale there.
Look at this. Look at that. Nice, shiny. Now, if you guys haven't got it yet, next couple of weeks, we're going to get these out, to you, but,
very nice, man.
Beautifully. They were nice. They did a nice job.
Who's the artist on board?
That was Jose Garcia.
Oh, no way. Okay, wow.
He did some pretty amazing Now, let's find some really nice pages in here. 144 pages? I think we're 144 pages full color.
Wow.
Yeah, he does. He has some beautiful.
That's a beaut.
It's very a beautiful nice. Book. Man. It's a beautiful book. And this is one that's kind of near and dear to us that we tried to. We actually pitched this to Scholastic and First Second Books, which Jose did work for First Second Books several years ago. And they didn't want to take a chance on it. But that's okay. We made probably made more money off of it doing it ourselves. And
oh, man, let me get anyway, you. So. Let me get you full on there again, too.
Yeah, so
very nice.
These were
very
nice. Yeah, it's a long time coming. Now we were a couple months late on these because the printer we used. I'm not going to go into to details. I don't want to go dunking on anybody. But the printer we used got sold in the middle of our job, which took us another like That's three or rough. 4 months to get the books. But they came in. They're beautiful. We have another book which actually Jin Wong and I think he's in the. Comment. We're getting that's actually off to the printers right now, but it's off to a different printer.
Oh, and, congrats, man. Like I said, you guys are busy. Holy smokes, man.
So we got comics going on. We've got we're working on developing a tabletop game right now. I think I mentioned that a little bit. We're doing the podcast. We got the websites. We got other businesses that I don't talk about online because I don't want my employees to get harassed. There's Jen. He's in the comic. Yeah, he worked on he did a clownfish TV comic book. So it's a comic book about us, and it's kind of interesting because he actually took and created stories out of things that we described in like our live streams and stuff. So it's really interesting to see somebody else's take on like, okay, we talk about this situation, then have somebody else draw that and be like, yeah, I guess it kind of happened that way, except maybe with fewer aliens. But yeah that you know,
needs more aliens. No such thing. No such thing as fewer. Needs more
aliens. Currently,
you got to think about representing them. They're going to take us over soon.
Yeah, there you go. Right. Currently, we're only selling the books through our website, and we're probably going to be selling through. We have an Amazon account. We're selling through Amazon too. We're going to set something up, I think, for retailers if they're interested. But yeah, as far as Diamond go, like we talked to Diamond years ago with Shadowbinders and. It just wasn't worth it because they were like, well, you put a book out like once a year. You know, it's like, what are we supposed to do with that? I'm like, yeah, that's pretty good. That's a pretty good point. So,
yeah, but that's a graphic novel size book, right? Isn't it? It's a thicker book. It's not like a single, like 24, 32 pager.
No, right? This is, yeah, it's hardcover.
That's a big guy.
It is a big guy. But, we've sold a lot of these, a couple thousand copies. So it's going to take a while for you guys to get your books. We're working as fast as we can to get them packed up and shipped out. It's just,
Are you guys handling that personally?
Yeah, we have a separate building we just do packing and shipping from. So
wow,
we got people working on that, and we're getting to you. I know some of the people in the chat said they got their notifications. So I think when the labels are printed, they get their notifications. I think that's the way that works. So.
Let's see. NXert, thanks for the super chat. Says, is the book on Comic Book Newsstand? Oh, that's the site that I'm running that you could just kind of submit it to.
Oh, okay. I wasn't sure if you're still doing that or not.
Yeah, so I'm still doing it, but submissions definitely have slowed down since we opened it up. But there's something like, I think, 80 to 90 different books on there that you can go on there and then just, click on the covers and just go check them out. So, yeah, it's free to list. So if anybody wants to, comicbooknewsstand.com. It's just the thing takes like 3 minutes to answer. It's just a quick field of a bunch of different things to fill in about the information on the book and you, and then just upload a cover image and you're done. And then we'll upload it to the site as long as you've sent us the image. A lot of people just do the info or just a cover image. You got to give us both. So if you're out there and you're wondering why haven't they listed it yet, make sure that you send in both, because I can't list it without the cover and I can't list it without the information. So other than that, free to use. And it's like an aggregate site, you know, everyone's all over the place nowadays. If it doesn't matter if you're on Kickstarter, Indiegogo, your own website, Fund My Comic, whatever, you can just send it there. As long as there's a link to send people to, it can go right there. Let's see, we have there's a couple people advocating for me to be on your show.
Okay, well, we might be able to make that happen.
That'll be fun. So now with the book, do you guys have a Do you guys have future plans for either other titles or the series, or what's happening with it? Or
yeah, so basically what we're going to do, because of the magic of YouTube, is we're going to be able to finish Shadowbinders, which was started as a webcomic. We actually were lucky enough to make a living mostly off of that at one point. For a couple of years, we made a living doing the webcomic, combination of webcomic and doing conventions, which that was a lot of work. I felt like a carny, right? Because we were like every weekend going someplace else. But we're able to finish that now. So hopefully I'm working on volume 3 and I'm going to get some help. I think we're probably looking at probably at least 10 or 12 volumes. I mean, the way the story was laid out. But wow. they're going to be graphic novels going forward. Because webcomic business model doesn't work very well. I mean, it really doesn't. I mean, it worked well when the ad rates were good, but we found that,
yeah,
you know, you can have millions of people. We did. At one point, we were on Keenspot, and we had millions of people reading our comic every month. And that translated into relatively little in advertising revenue compared to, like, YouTube or something like that. So, and then fewer people bought the comics. Like, you know, we print the comics up and we'd have, you know, like less than 1% of the people that actually read it for free would buy it because there's no incentive to buy it. I mean, you're reading it for free, right? And it's going to be on the internet forever, right? So, and then the other problem we had with it was, and this is my complaint as the artist, was I was always rushed because it was like you had to keep that schedule. Like, we always updated 2 or 3 times a week, full color, and I had a day job on top of it. So it was like, I just kind of slammed out whatever I could slam out, and I hated it because I could never lay it out right. And then I'd get a couple pages in and go back and be like, ah, shit, I missed something. Sorry, I already swore, so it's already ruined. But I missed something, so I can't, but the page is already posted, right? So what am I supposed to do? You know, this way I can actually lay a whole book out like a regular comic book artist and be like, yeah, we're going to lay the whole book out and then we're going to draw it. And make sure we get all the bugs worked out first. So it should be a lot more coherent, you know, than just slamming pages out every week. Because it's a grind. I mean, it really is a grind. And the webcomic scenes, it was good about 10, 15 years ago, but then Webtoon came along and basically just gobbled up everything.
Yeah. It's like anything else. When that playing field gets leveled, and I've seen so many people preach about how great it is now, the playing field's leveled. Okay, well, now it's leveled. Yeah, that's great. Barrier to entry is a lot lower.
Yes.
But with the barrier to entry being a lot lower, now there's that competition now that you have to cut through that noise, through the roof. So if you don't have a plan to cut through the noise, you're screwed. It doesn't matter about the playing field being leveled. Then when you get certain places like Comixology coming along, and then they have their own publishing, you know, Submit, and they're now publisher, retailer, distributor, essentially in some way, shape, or form. As soon as they did that, I noticed, and that's why we left, I noticed that they just could care less anymore to push any other independent whatsoever.
It's kind of that way with, I mean, I like Webtoon, but it's kind of that way over there now, too, is they push their big titles from Korea, and, you know, anybody they have a deal with, so if they have a deal with, you know, some other entertainment company or whatever, very few people actually get through on their own merit. I mean, you'll have occasionally something like Lore Olympus where, you know, it was just so good and so popular that it kind of broke through that, you're not going to see a comic come up through organically anymore. No. Not like it used to be. And you know, webcomics in general, there used to be the barrier to entry that you had to run your own website. You had to be able to, you know, manage your own website, market your own website, and handle all that stuff yourself. So a lot of people that did webcomics early on, maybe they weren't like the best artists, but they knew how to code and they could, you know, handle all that stuff. And again, the barrier to entry now, everybody can post, and you just really have to sort through the noise. And I don't even know if I would tell anybody to do that now. You know, I mean, there's a massive audience out there for webcomics, but it is so hard to get noticed. I mean, I wouldn't even know where to start now. If I were going to start now, I have no idea where I'd even begin.
I don't even know if this would work, but if I was going to go about it at this point, I would dedicate a Twitter and Instagram account to it. and just treat it like posting it up there and have a website where there's some kind of merch or something else available or whatever. If you've got enough eventually and you want to do a printed thing or sell the compiled digital file or something like that. But I can't even imagine at this point getting into it in terms of the traditional way. And that even goes for print publishing too. Yeah. You know, I can't imagine if I started Alterna right now, I would not even want to pursue distribution in any traditional sense. I would just be doing exactly what we're doing right now, selling direct, doing crowdfunding, promoting on social media, build that up, put all of that time and investment into your own stuff, as opposed to spending years and years of it, putting it into a different system. And then that system just it's broken, and eventually you're going to find out. And then when you go to leave it, you're going to realize, oh crap, I'm so far behind, and I could have put all that time and effort and energy and money into building up my own thing and be 5, 6, 10 years ahead of where I should have been.
Yeah, I think that's the biggest mistake that creators make now, is that they, you know, like I remember when I wanted to break into comics, it was all about you create the sample pages, sample packets. You know, and I had interviews at DC, and so before I started doing the Disney stuff, and it was all like, okay, I'm going to do another 5 or 6 page sample packet, and I'm going to schlep it around to the conventions, I'm going to push it in the editors' faces, and I'm going to make my Xerox copies. Remember Xerox copies? That was the thing. You make Xerox copies, throw it in an envelope, and then you'd get like, you know, a couple letters back. You know, form letters sometimes. Sometimes you get a handwritten letter, and it was just a very, like, all the time I spent sending out sample packets for years before I finally broke in, I could have drawn a couple of comics and sold them and used that as my sample packet. Here's my finished comic book. Here, look at this. I actually finished a comic book. So I would tell people now, finish a comic book, finish a story, you know, and use that as your sample. Stop drawing so much damn fan art. I mean, I understand there's a place for it, and if you want to get noticed. But I mean, we had people working for us at one point. Actually, one of the colorists on Shadowbinders, like 10 years ago, and they've gone on to other stuff. But they were spending more time doing fan art online, trying to break in. I'm like, we're actually giving you better page rates than like what IDW or somebody's gonna pay, and you're drawing all this.
Oh,
like,
goodness, this Steven Universe. I don't even want to go down the road of if you people complain about Marvel and DC page rates. I mean, I know people that have worked for, you know, Boom, IDW, Dark Horse, and they're getting
bucks,
paid. Oh,
bucks.
Yeah, it's insane. Yeah. I'm like, what the hell are you doing?
Yeah, it's exposure.
And they're like,
right?
Oh, exposure. What the hell? Exposure, my ass. What's wrong with you?
We were actually paying
$20 a page.
Yeah, we were actually paying this person more than they were getting paid for the other stuff they were doing, and they were like blowing our deadlines to do fan art of Steven Universe because they were like addicted to the dopamine hit, I think, of getting all these upvotes, and so we had to part ways. I'm like, I'm only asking you to color like 2 or 3 pages a week, and we're paying you a pretty good rate for what you're doing. It's just I don't have time. And but then they wound up working for other publishers. I'm like, well, you're gonna find out that it's gonna be a different story there because they're gonna pay you less, and it's gonna take a lot longer to get paid. But you got your fan art, right? That you can't really. I mean, I get that's a good way to break in to get an audience, but you know, again, if you're gonna spend that much effort on something, I would recommend doing it on your own stuff. Trying to, you know,
absolutely.
You know, just work from there and complete stories. If you want to sell comics, now if you just want to sell or get a gig, you know, working on a licensed T-shirt or some crap like that, then that's a totally different thing. But if you want to make comic books, then make a damn comic book and make a comic book featuring your own characters that you actually can use, that you can sell or whatever.
Yeah, yeah. I can't wrap my mind around when I've talked to people about that, and I just it seems like it's an impossible conversation. Like it's someone who's, you're stuck in the matrix kind of a thing, you know, and they just like down in blue pills every day. And they're like, yum, 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 blue pill. Give me more blue pill.
Yeah. it's like you're spending all this time
only,
on somebody
only
else's
the blue
stuff.
Pill is, it's not like you're living a great life in the matrix. Cause then it's like, all right, I can, you know, I won't begrudge you it. But you're like, give me some of them blue pills so I can live in a refrigerator on the alley. Yeah, it's so great.
then they get upset when the money's not there, and they get upset when, you know, it's like, I don't know what to tell you. There are just so many. And honestly, I mean, the truth, and this is, and we can wrap it up here pretty soon, but I'm just like, the brutally honest truth, and I hate to break it to all you youngins, all you kids out there, the brutally honest truth is there are more people that want to make comics than there are people that want to read comics now. There are so many people that want to make comics. Now, wanting to make comics and actually being able to make comics are two different things. And if you actually start making your own comic, you're already ahead of 95% of the competition. You know, so my advice for you would be to just start making stuff, start making it, and start promoting
Absolutely.
It. Bet on yourself. Again, you know, fan art's nice occasionally, but at the end of the day, that's not going to be what gets you a gig.
Absolutely. And yeah, Luke, I agree. Man, oh man, I've had that experience with quite a few. But yeah, I think we're also going to see something with this advent of AI, where some people are thinking all doom and gloom about it, that, oh, it's going to erase all of humanity in terms of art and everything, like the comics, and they're just going to take over. Everyone's going to use AI and whatever. And I'm not going to say that people aren't going to go that route. But I think we're going to see the people out there that are willing, capable, and want to do it as a human being creating stories, and as a human being wanting to buy stories that human beings make. I think we're going to be seeing an uptick in that, and I think we're going to see people just by virtue of nothing other than the fact of that, once again, leveling the playing field and making that barrier to entry lower than ever before imaginable. We're going to see more people cut through the noise and be creative, and not just competitive, but cooperative, because it's going to take everybody coming together to go, you know what, we got to help each other promote. We got to help each other get out there. We got to utilize this of what's occurring, and we're already seeing that kind of happening, but I think we're going to see like rocket boosters on a bunch of different creators out there that are just going to do pedal to the metal, because they're not going to go doom and gloom on it, and they're going to just make some really great stuff that's going to stand out. And I don't know if I'm being overly positive about it, but man, I just get a feeling, I got a gut feeling that there's going to be people getting really creative in the face of AI being used in some capacity to create comics.
You're going to have to be, because you're going to have to stand out, right? So,
yeah.
And yeah, I mean, it's a very real fear, and I know this is a huge discussion that's coming up. I mean, the reality of the situation is you're not going to be able to avoid AI completely. Everybody's adopting it. Adobe's building it into their products right now. Google is going to be using it. Quora is already using it. You ask a question on Quora, it's got, you know, chatbot. You know, all these websites are using it to help with listicles and stuff. It's not going anywhere. It really isn't. It is going to be another tool. Now, is it going to replace people where it shouldn't? Yeah, unfortunately. But I think we're going to find out, you know, pretty early on that it's not going to be it's not going to be a replacement for actual human artists that have that creativity, because all AI can do currently is just repurpose, you know, basically things that have already been done, you know, just pull from existing. So I think we are going to get some wilder concepts and some things that, you know, AI would not be able to think of, because there's nothing else like it. And that's going to be really exciting. And that's going to be out of necessity. You know, you can't just do another buy the books, whatever, because that can be done by computer, but you want to do something that is completely different, that's completely outside the box, visually, storytelling wise, whatever, then yeah, that's going to take a human to do that.
And so storytelling wise, especially, inject some heart into it, you know,
right.
get some of that introspective kind of stuff that made storytelling so great in comic books in particular. One thing here I wanted to address really quick. Gordon Goodbrother asks, has any indie writer ever asked a freelance artist what he wants to draw? In some capacity, that's actually how I hire artists for King Cryptid. And I know I'm in a different situation with that, because I've got a bunch of issues and a bunch of the way it's told with episodic storytelling, and a lot of the issues are very clearly a complete story, but there's overarching continuity. I'll just approach him and be like, you know, this story has more of a horror feel with a werewolf. This story's got more of a sci-fi kind of thing going on. This story, you know, what kind of thing seems like you'd be really good for it? I think you'd be good for this, but let me know what you think. And that's how I'll approach it when there's an artist that I'm interested in working with. But I don't know. Have you ever done that?
No,
Yeah, I don't think most people do.
I think usually, well, at least in the, I mean, we don't have a lot of experience hiring other artists yet, for the most part. Like I said, with Crimson Wren, that was an existing world. So, you know, when we talked with Jose, it was like, it's got to look like it belongs with the rest of Shadowbinders. You can put your own spin on it stylistically, but it still has to look like it can mesh up, you know, with this, that they're not two totally different worlds. So, you know, anything else we do, I think I at least stuff I would write, I think I would probably have a pretty good idea of how I wanted it to look. The artist might come in, you know, give me some other ideas and say, hey, wouldn't it be cool if we did X, Y, Z thing? I might be like, yeah, it's actually pretty cool. But I think, you know, if we're going to, you know, if it's work for hire, I think I'm probably going to kind of already have an idea. And that sounds very draconian to me.
I think that's how most people operate, though. And I think that's how, yeah, you know, it's different than ruling over the comic with an iron fist.
Yeah, it's different. Like, hey, here's kind of what I was thinking, you know, something like that. Give me a couple of ideas or whatever. Or just use your, it doesn't really matter what that looks like. Just here's basically, you know, what it is. And I'd like to think that, you know, we hire people that are competent enough to kind of understand, you know, what's going on, that we don't have to go over everything with a, you know, be like, oh yeah, every freaking panel we got to go over just to make sure you actually know how to do comics. And
Man, oh man. All right, guys, thank you so much for being here tonight. Neon, man, oh man, thank you. It was good to catch up with you, brother. And we got to do this again soon. We'll work it out. I know we're both busy, but we'll find a day and time again like we did today.
All right, thank you very much for having me.
No problem, man. Everybody in the chat, thank you guys for being here tonight. And once again, I would just like to thank Neon and also remind you guys, too, the King Cryptid campaign hit over 500 backers, so we've got another bonus unlocked. Yeah, I love unlocking these bonuses, too, for the backers. So this one's going to be a signed 6x9 print. If you haven't had a chance to back it yet, you can back it on either Indiegogo or on alternacomics.com, and this is to fund issues 5 to 9. 1 to 4 are available right now, so you can actually pick those up if you want them. They're on the Alterna site. I'm going to be packing up orders literally as soon as this stream ends, and I'm going to be getting out all the rest of fulfillment for the winter campaign tomorrow, and along with a bunch of the back orders that are waiting. And you guys have been so patient and so awesome with that, so thank you guys so much. Everybody, once again, thank you guys for being here. Great conversation tonight, and Neon, all the best, brother. Hope to talk to you soon, and and yeah, we'll be in touch. Everyone, take it easy. I'll be back Tuesday night at 9 o'clock, and we'll see if my guest shows up as well. We'll see. But I'll be back Tuesday night at 9. See you then, guys. Everybody, have a great night, and take it easy.